It's always a pleasure to be here. As you all know, I have worked a lot on Russian banks, or maybe as some of you don't know, but I've worked a lot on Russian banks. But this is not on Russian banks. It's on a Belgian bank, and it's not what I usually do. It's about bank runs and bank loyalty, but it's focusing on social networks. So something entirely new for me, and somehow you're trying to make you crazy by the lights, eh? But it's something something very new for me. So I'm looking forward to any comments or suggestions that could improve the stuff. What is it going to be about? It's going to be about peer effects, and it's going to be about peer effects. So you all know what the definition of peer effects are. It's choices of peers that influence another's decision making. So we have a set of agents, and they influence each other's decisions. In my case, these agents are going to be depositors. And we're going to ask the question, if there is a situation of panic, if some bank has diminished solvency and people are asking questions, is there any peer effect? Are people going to base their exit decisions to leave the bank on what other people think about the bank? This is the idea. Huh? So it's in a way about propagation of behavior through a social network. That's the idea. And it's in that sense, it's a new contribution, we believe, to the financial stability literature. Because a lot of literature about financial stability and about crisis, but very little literature on how, so people talk about market discipline, about fundamentals, about how this information affects bank stability, but very few people talk about how this information actually spreads. And this is about the information spreading through networks, social networks. Okay. So what is it related to? First, there's a huge literature on herd behavior. I'd only name very few papers, but actually if you start diving into it, it's a huge mass of papers on herding behavior. Herding behavior in investment, herding behavior in social things, herding behavior in banking. You have herding pretty much everywhere. Now there's quite a few theories, but one of the theories is herding based on informational differences. And there you have this whole idea of Banerjee, Welch, and other guys. So Welch actually is kind of interesting. He talks about informational cascades. And his idea is basically, if people don't know very well the subject, so for example, think about why do people smoke? Why do people smoke? They know that smoking is not healthy, right? You know you're gonna die. For the people smoke, you're gonna die earlier. Huh? But you kind of disregard this information, especially if you're young, because you know a lot of other people that are also smoking. And from their behavior, you infer it cannot be that bad. So an informational cascade is that in your decision, you attach more importance to the signal received from others than to your own signal. And that's how you get observational learning, right? I see what others do, and from that I learn how healthy smoking is. And you're very wrong, but it's an informational cascade. Eh? And this can lead to bubbles and all this kind of thing. Eh? You have this whole discussion about payoff externalities. This is related to, this is typically for banking, and it's related to liquidity constraints. So basically, in the banking environment, specifically, it's very simple. Banks have a liquidity constraint. So if you all at the same time as a herd go and ask for money from the bank will inevitably go bankrupt because you have externalities. Each of us together, we create externalities for each other. Because if we don't jointly herd and go to the bank will survive. If we jointly herd, we create externalities to each other and the bank will fail. You also have simple imitation, this whole theory of imitation of Derrida and Welch, where people that have no fundamentals don't understand, simply imitate. So it's not even about attaching weights to your own information, all this information, just about I'm going to imitate because I have no information. There's a whole different literature because you're going to work on social networks, which talks about information diffusion on networks. This is also very, very large. One set of theories talks about network density. And clearly, if a network is more dense, information diffusion is going to happen much more quick. So if you have a lot of ties, it means the likelihood is much larger that actually you're gonna make the information flow on the network. So more dense networks should have more contagion. That's the idea. That's a very old idea. Actually, it also depends on the strength of ties. If your tie is very strong, then it's very likely that you are going to be influenced by this tie, right? This is but actually, it's not too sure, because these two theories kind of contradict each other. This theory says the strength of ties, if you have stronger ties, there will be more information transmitted. On the other hand, if all of us are strongly tied, we're very likely to have the same set of information already. So maybe just contagion, but contagion of what? We already know all the things we know, because we know the same thing. So in that case, actually, and this is the theory of Granovetter of the weak ties, maybe it's the weak ties that are more important. Because the weak ties, they, although they are weaker, they have new information. And this new information they bring is much more likely to change the behavior and so lead to hurting. So in fact, how this works technically is, why are the weak ties more influential than the strong ties? Because the weak ties are actually in the network more central, usually. If you have many weak ties, you're actually more central in the network. So this, it's these central players that have many, many weak ties that are actually are able to create more contagion. So, and the fight is still on, right? We are not sure yet how this will end, but there's a whole discussion going on of how network structure affects information diffusion. And this is going to matter, because if people start to run on the bank, how does it actually happen? They just watch television and at some point they start to panic, or they read about others, or they see, they talk to the neighbors, their family, and they say, oh, did you hear about the bank? Yeah, I heard it too, and I'm going to get my money tomorrow. Oh, sure, I should go today. How does this work? How does this information spread, and how does the run happen? Some of you have been in a run, right? I have been in some runs in Russia. So how do you learn about it? In my case, I usually read something or.
Our babushka always used Sberbank, and we do the same.
So your solution is go to Sberbank. But did you know that Sberbank had a run in '98? A quite big run, actually. Yes. So it's only safe because it was saved by the government. But it was it always will be saved by the government, of course. But it needed some injections then. So which brings us to the bank run literature. Thank you for the bank run link. And there are a lot of papers about bank runs, an endless stream of papers actually. So this is by itself is a whole overview paper. But there's two big flows in this literature. One flow is coordination problems. So basically the problem is there, everybody is jointly making a decision. This is the basic idea of diamond and deep thief that was used by many others. But in this kind of framework, banking is inherently unstable. I should stand still probably for you. Sorry, I keep walking around, that's my habit. Now I realize I should not move. I will stand here and only move my arms like this so that people on the internet have a nice view of me. So the whole idea of simultaneous equation, how does that work? The idea is, imagine a bank is healthy. And all of us know it's healthy. But most of us think the others think it's not healthy. So although we all believe the bank is healthy, it's enough that I believe that you believe the bank is not healthy for me to be rational to run on the bank. Because if I believe that you will run on the bank and enough of you will run on the bank, and since I know that the bank's liquidity is limited, and that after enough money is withdrawn, the bank will close, I should be first and run on the bank first, even though I know the bank is healthy. Because you have what they call the sequential servicing constraint. The banks will give the money first to who is first until it's over. And then the bank closes and that's it. So just expectations about the behavior of others, even if the expectation is wrong, is enough to create a bank run. This is the classical diamond and Diefig idea, and this is why we have things like deposit insurance. So every bank which does fractional reserve banking, that has not the full liquidity to cover withdrawals, is subject to this kind of runs, where the bank is actually healthy, but there's a lack of trust, there's a panic, and people run and the whole thing will collapse. And it can always happen. So every bank is subject to this. How do we solve it? As I said, deposit insurance, don't worry, it's insured, and lender of last resort. If the bank is solvent, it should always be able to borrow money from the central bank and get liquidity and solve the problem. And since we say this to people, since I say deposit insurance, since I say lender of last resort, if I know the bank is healthy, I do not longer have a reason to run on the bank. Because I know even if there's a liquidity problem, it will be solved by these other ways and I will be safe. So it prevents bank runs. You have another literature that says, no, it's not about expectations. It's about fundamentals. The reason why people run on the bank is because they have a belief about the fundamental. Come in. No fears. Hi, meet you. So in this literature, it's about sequential decision making. So some people know, have information, there are informational asymmetries, right? Some people know something about the bank before others do. They say, oh, something is rotten in the state of this bank. I will run. And others that do not observe the bank fundamentals may observe the behavior. It's close to the information cascades of Welch. And since I observe the behavior, I infer something about fundamentals and I will run too. This is actually endogenous peer effects. And we are going to situate ourselves in this line of research. What we're going to do is we're going to talk about endogenous peer effects. We're going to see whether my decision to exit the bank depends on observed decisions by others to leave the bank. This is the idea of the paper. Right? There's a lot of empirical research on this. There's a lot of experimental evidence on this. Actually, in the paper, you have many more citations on bank stability, bank runs, also on Russian papers. But I will limit myself here to some general things. The last literature we are situated in is the literature on depositor discipline. Right? Because we're going to talk about what happens during crisis time. And of course, often there's not a full out bank run, but there's an increased sensitivity for bank fundamentals. That's something different. People got more worried about the bank solvency. And so there's an increased sensitivity of deposit growth and interest rates to bank capital, for example. So the literature has found two things. One part of the literature has found that a crisis reduces depositor discipline. So in the crisis, then people get less panicky about the health of the banks. Why? Because the government steps in. And as we have seen in the West, all over the place in 2008, but also in Russia in 2008 and 2014, if push comes to shove, if the crisis really strikes, the government will actually step in. They will increase the deposit insurance limits, they will recapitalize the banks, they will put liquidity into the banks, all these things Russia did. So, and because the depositors observe this thing, they actually will reduce deposit discipline. So, you could say, is there any lullaby effect? And there's a paper from Hassan that says that people start to look at other people, and if other people stay calm because of the message of the government, everybody will stay calm. So people start to look more at what other people think during crisis times, and if you manage to calm most people, you calm everybody. So fundamentals become less important. That's more hurting. And you could have like a peer effect, and a lullaby is like da, 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 that's a lullaby. So make you go to sleep. You have the opposite findings. Actually, there's a whole literature on this very old one. We wrote one paper on this on Russia, basically that financial crisis increases the positive discipline. So people get more worried. And in 98, it was very clear that actually this was the case in Russia. In 2004 and 2008, this was less the case. But 2008, clearly, households became, in 98, I'm sorry, households became much more worried about the health of the banks after the crisis and before the crisis. So there could be a wake-up call effect or lullaby effect. And what is it going to be? So this is what we are situating ourselves into. And what is the contribution? We're going to, first of all, see, is there any endogenous peer effect in bank exits? Do people, if they decide to leave the bank altogether, look at other people leaving the bank together? In the peer effects, we're going to look at household effects and family effects, so the larger family effects, and also actually neighborhood effects. If your neighbors leave the bank, if your son or father or daughter leaves the bank, if your nephew or aunt or mother-in-law leaves the bank, does it affect your decision to leave the bank later on? This is it. It's very simple, the setup, actually. And we're going to verify whether these things are affected by the crisis. Is it the case that in crisis time, the peer effects become stronger? and also that the weak ties, as Granovetter predicts, become stronger. Do you go watch broader peer effects? Yes? So is there a power of weak ties? This is the idea. Of course, if you have ever, and oh, I have this, okay. Thanks for the improved, Taras. See, I'm learning. Yeah. So let's talk about the data and the methodology. We convinced a big European commercial bank that had a bank run in the Belgian retail market in 2008 to give us data. Huh. And the data is of individuals. We don't know the names, obviously, of these people, but we know everything else. So we know snapshot month by month by the amount of deposits they have. We know how old they are. We know whether they are married or divorced or a widower. We know their income. We know which bank branch they are. We know their address, more or less, the street code. We know whether they have an account manager, whether they visited the bank, how many times they visited the bank, how many sales they had, how many products they have, whether they have a mortgage or not. We know the quality of the bank branch. So we know a lot of individual data of these people. And what we're basically going to try to do is, with this data set, predict who will exit the bank and who will stay with the bank. Okay? So we have 307,000 customers in Belgium. 10,000 of these were drawn randomly. So we asked the bank, draw us from the whole list of numbers, draw us 10,000 random people. And then from these 10,000 random people, we asked the bank, draw us family members and neighbors, in total 8. And of these 8, draw us again 8 family members and neighbors. And so the family member could be anything like a son, a father, or a wife. And that's how in the second round you can actually go to mother-in-law, nephew, a son of my brother is a nephew. So you can have, because of these two rounds of networks, you can have neighbors of neighbors, you can have neighbors of family, you can have nephews, mothers-in-laws, all these kind of things. So, yes?
So how do you identify neighbors? I mean, you have the address, you compare the addresses?
We have the street codes, and if the street code is identical, we call them a neighbor. Yeah.
So, that doesn't mean they know each other, though?
No. That's a weakness. And we also find for neighbors very weak effects. Yeah. Exactly. So, the neighbors are just identified. So, there are two things. We know they live close to each other, and we know they have the same bank. And the silent assumption is that people, if there's a crisis and are in the same bank, are more likely to talk about this bank than they are at the butcher or somewhere at the street. And so I've presented this paper in many places. Many people say in the south of Europe, you're crazy. People will never talk about the bank. People in Holland say, of course, I will talk to everybody about the bank. So your likelihood to believe this depends a lot on how open and transparent the society is. In Russia, I don't think anyone would do this, talk about the bank on the street, but in some other countries, people actually do that. You would definitely talk in Russia with your family members. This is the close network, so you would talk with your mother, your father, your son, maybe even your uncle or aunt about if there's a real banking crisis, watch out for this bank. So this is basically the idea.
Would you ever consider to include co-workers in the list? People talk about banks at work as well.
Yes, but you have to remember, we have the data from the bank. Yeah. And the bank doesn't know that the people are co-workers.
Because they employed in the same place.
Yeah, but the bank doesn't know. Right. The bank doesn't know where they are employed. The bank just sees the money coming. Mm-hmm. What you basically could do is...
The bank is supposed to know.
Sorry?
Bank is supposed to know.
Try to ask a bank before they can get the data. It takes them 5 years, basically. But the bank should be able to know because they know the account number, right? And the account number who pays. So you could basically cluster people.
No, it's
people.
Like a list of data
which you fill. Not in Belgium. Not in Belgium. So I get a wage, and the wage is, I said to the firm I work, pay the wage to this bank. The firm isn't deciding it. I'm deciding it.
Yes, you do.
So, and the bank doesn't know all the firms. They don't make a list of the firms where people work. Not in Belgium.
Yes. In Russia they do, but I'm not sure about Belgium.
Belgium.
I think when I started in the Netherlands, the bank didn't know, my employer that I studied at the university.
So the banks could know, but they don't. So in the data sets of the bank, they have who is the account number of who is paying, and they could link the account. Of course, in many cases, the account number is an account from another bank. So imagine I got my money with this bank, but my employee, the firm, the university, pays me from another bank account. So basically, as far as Forte sees, it's one bank account paying to another bank, and they don't know this bank account and the other bank who it is from. Right? You see? They don't have the identity. They could look it up probably, but it's not in any data set. So. If to do this, they should go look at to the payments data. And then in the payments data, look at the payment transfer and list all the identities. But they don't do that. Yes?
And I'm wondering about your sample. Does it mean that about 300,000 customers are the number of all the customers in this bank?
Or no.
It's just
no. No.
10-30% of this.
It is about 10%.
10%.
So it's a random sample, and then from this sample, it's stratified for the sample. So it's not a full bank. But since there's so many people, there's not a lot you can say. Yes, yes, yes.
Can you tell me, please, you have many languages in Belgium. What languages these people use? French?
All three. All three, meaning German, French, and Dutch. Actually, Dutch, French, and German, if you take the most important language first in terms of people using it. But, yes. So it's not being selected by a part of the country. It's a random selection of 10,000 people, and from there, it's constructed a network. This by itself, let me show you the next slide. This by itself was very difficult for the bank. They have this data somewhere, but it's all disorganized. So we ask them, give us 10,000 people, and from these 10,000 people, give us family and neighbors again, and that was very hard for the bank to do, because they're not used to drawing samples. Their data is not organized like this. They know more or less this person is a family of this person this way, but it's not structured in a way to easily sample at all. But they're not doing research usually. So basically, what do we have? We also know whether a client is active in daily banking, deposits and investment, loans and credits, insurance, and online banking. These are the five domains. And we also know the amounts, actually, of these things. And then we're going to ask ourselves, is there any bank exits? We're going to use two variables. One variable is bank exit defined by us. And bank exit defined by us is basically if we see that in all five categories, there's no activity anymore. There's no money in the deposits, all the insurance has been closed, the loans have been paid off, and there's no daily bank activity anymore. We basically say this is an exit. Although the account may still exist. We just complete passivity, we say it's an exit. A second dependent variable is processed by the bank. So the bank itself also has created a variable like lost clients. And they look at the data and say, this client is gone. And this data processed by the bank is a subset of our data. So we have a very much broader definition of bank exit at the bank. The bank really says someone who closes all the accounts and really goes away. We say no activity in any of the main domains is a bank exit. So anyone who is processed by the bank as an exit is also defined by us, but not the other way around. We define many more people as an exit than the bank does. Okay? And we have client characteristics and events, we have branch characteristics and events, and so on. Okay, this is the flow of bank exits. You always see a peak at the end of the year, and that's because, for example, the problem is that if you do this deposit and investments, the bank sets them on zero at the end of the year. So at the end of the year, you see many more observations, and so you have this this technical regularity. And you see also the Lehman peak. So this is the bank run we talk about, right? So they had a little bank run here that was unexpectedly high, in fact. Okay. And you have the end of year peaks always, but this was a kind of special peak. So what is the model? The model is going to be very simple, actually. It's a proportional a Cox hazard model, and we're going to do two models. The first model is extremely simple. The hazard is the likelihood that you leave the bank. It's this kind of a model. It's a model of the family links, and the family link, the family variable is just very simple. It just counts the number of family members that have left the bank 6 months before. That's it. Neighbors, the same thing. The number of neighbors that have left the bank 6 months before. And Z are all the controls. And all the controls are individual characteristics, how old you are, when did you become a client, married or not, a widower or not, divorced or not, all these things. Bank branch characteristics, for example, the efficiency and the performance of the branch. Client's product characteristics, what kind of products does he buy, has a mortgage or not, how many sales did he have, and so on. Relationship characteristics, how often does he go to the bank, does he have an account manager, did the account manager change. Life events, did someone die, did you get an inheritance. Bank events, did the branch name change, did the branch move of place, did the account manager change of name, a different person is your manager. And relationship events, for example, how many sales did you have the last year? How many times the last year did the person go on the online banking? So you can control for a lot of things usually you can't control for, and still see whether the family relation matters. If I show you the results, you should keep in mind that hazard rates are not coefficients. So how should you read it? If you see something above 1, so 1.5 means 50% more likely to leave. 0.8 is going to mean 20% less likely to leave. The benchmark is 1. So you have to think in probabilities. These are hazards, right? So don't think in coefficients. So there will be no negative coefficients, right? Negative is smaller than 1. Positive is larger than 1. That's very important. If you look at the tables, keep this in mind. This is the way to look at the tables. And the clue, the key factor is, you're going to estimate also, of course, then the second estimation is, you're going to split out the family to first order family close, fathers, sons, mothers living at the same place. First order family far, people in the same family but living at a different place. It could be my son or my father, but you live in a different address, and you have an alternative definition for this. We are in the same family, but you have a different bank branch. So maybe you live in a different address, but the next doors, right? Maybe you have just a quartier next to your father, but no, we don't allow this. So the far could be far in terms of address or far in terms of a different bank branch. Or maybe far could mean the student is studying at university, but every weekend he's still living with his parents, and de facto he lives at his parents. He just goes to study. But then if it's a different bank branch, that's not going to be the case. Then you have the first order family for people that are divorced. Maybe the household has a different address, but the reason is they have divorced. And maybe they still take some decisions on the finance together for the children. And then you have second order family, aunts, nephews, mothers-in-law, sons-in-law, and all this stuff. And then you have neighbors. And again, all the shit list of control variables, basically. Okay, this is the setup. And then we're going to do this before, during, and after the crisis. Because, so since it is a proportional hazard model, you cannot do interactions with crisis dummies, because you assume the hazard is constant over the period you're looking at. So what you can do is you can split the sample in before the 2008 crisis, during the crisis, and after the crisis, and then you would expect that these family effects are stronger during the crisis, if you believe the theories that exist. Because in crisis times, it's more salient, people will talk more, weak ties will become more important, and so on and so on. Okay? This is the sampling information. So you see, you have the subsample of initial 10,000, and then all customers is 307,000, and then you see some guys were never active, some actually died, and this is the revealed exits and the processed bank exits. So we're going to actually try to explain these, the revealed exits and the processed bank exits. You can see this is broader than this by looking at these, right? So the all customers, this is going to be, here is going to be the family members, the neighbors, and the fact the fact that they leave will predict the fact that these guys leave. Yes? This is the idea. This is the setup of the paper. So let me throw you at the results. So of course the table is two pages long and very small print, because you have all these control variables. I can show all of these and they all make sense, but so for example, having a mortgage, a very small coefficient. It means having a mortgage makes you much more likely to stay, a lot less likely to exit. Smaller than one, this coefficient. So all these control variables make a lot of sense, and they are very important. But we are interested in this variable, the family variable. And you see pre-crisis, during the crisis, and post the crisis. So there's two things to observe. First of all, we observe definitely that family matters. It's actually the strongest predictor. The strongest predictor of bank exit by a lot is family members leaving the bank. You're 200% more likely, 300% more likely to leave the bank if family members have left the bank. You also see that during the crisis time, it's a lot larger. So the effect jumps up and down again. So it seems to be first intermediate results, family peer effects matter, family peer effects matter, and they matter more during the crisis. It's a wake-up call effect. So that's kind of interesting. The next thing we're going to do is going to try to split these effects, as this equation 2 I was talking about, right? So this is equation 2. The only thing we did is split the family variable in first order family close, first order family far, second order family, and the neighbors stay the same. This close, why do we have now 6 columns? Well, the far has been based on the address, as I showed you, a different address, or has been based on branch. So in the calculation of this variable, counting the number of people that exit the bank 6 months before you exit, and far mean we're going to look at family members that live in a different address or in different bank branch. And these are the two sets of columns, yes? And what you find the same results. You find here, for example, with the branch, which is, I think, the strongest result, it's a different branch, I really are far. You see, first of all, that the family, that first order and close and far matter. So it's not only a household effect. It's not only a family living together. It's also a family effect. Because the far people are people really in a different bank branch. And it's very strong, almost comparable. You also see that during the crisis, the second order family starts to matter. This is the weak ties. What happens is at birthday parties during Christmas, when people see each other, large families, and there's a crisis time, then the banking crisis is so salient, they do talk about it. And it matters. People, if their peers, nephews leave the bank, they're much more likely to leave the bank too. It's a huge number, right? 300% more likely to leave the bank if your nephews leave the bank. So actually, the bank has found this so important. We did this as a consultancy project for a bank, and the bank has put it in production now. So they now follow the family relations, and if they see a local infection of family members starting to leave, they immediately take action and address all the other families and say, what is wrong? Can we help you? Are you not pleased with the service of the bank? So they use it as a warning signal now to improve the bank's operations. Because it was by far the strongest effect, much more than account managers or something else. And you see the same effect here with addresses, you have exactly the same, very comparable. So although the calculation is very different, they're very comparable results. So, and in all the cases you see, in the crisis times, it's much stronger, a lot stronger, especially for the far family and the second order family. So you see both the second order family effect, and you see the crisis effect. Okay? Now the next thing we do, and of course this includes all the control variables. So we always include the whole list, and they are an annex of the paper, but it's impossible to show all that stuff. Although by itself it's worth 2 or 3 papers, because you can look at the effect of mortgages, of captive products, of account managers. You can also solve the question, if I do hard selling, I sell more products, are people more loyal or less loyal? So these are all interesting questions, but you can only do so much in one paper. Okay, then we do sensitivity analysis. the first thing I'm going to do is, let's have an alternative dependent variable. Huh? The thing we're going to do first is, okay, let's look at the processed bank exit. Remember, that is the bank itself deciding the exits. And if you go back, you remember that this, first table, that this is instead of 1,700 dependent variables, you will have 961. So just less people leaving. Huh? So it's a subset, basically. Okay, I'm going too quick. Then we're going to change the definition of the crisis period. So we now looked at the story in the newspaper, but you can also look at the stock price of this bank. The stock price started to fall quite a bit before the actual crisis. So we look at the stock price. And then we look at the Lehman Brothers event. This is the Lehman Brothers event. So you can vary with the crisis periods depending on the criteria you use for it. And you can also include branch performance, because we didn't include branch performance because some people said it's going to be endogenous, but you can include it. So let's first start by the other dependent variable. So what do we have now? Remember I showed you the first model of simply the family, and then the second model with an address and a branch version with a family close for and a family. And that's what we have here. We have the three models in one. What do we see? The first thing we see is the same result as before. During the crisis times, peer effects go up massively. You have the second order family effect. And interestingly, you now also have a neighbor effect, a small one. But imagine how weakly it is measured. Huh? It's people living in the same street. You don't know whether they ever talk to each other. But in crisis times, apparently they do. And you see the same actually here, and the same here. So with the alternative dependent variable, there's also a very weak tie effect of neighbors. The effect is much smaller. It's also borderline significant, yeah? But it's there. Yeah? So there are very weak indications that even neighbors may have an effect. If you would actually know who of these neighbors actually talk to each other, most likely the effect would be stronger. But we can't measure that. The bank doesn't know which neighbors talk to each other. Maybe they could know if they grab Facebook of Contactje, but this is future dreams. At this moment, we don't know. Okay. The next thing we do is look at different crisis periods. So this is the crisis from June 2008 till May 2009. Looking at the stock price, it's very robust in every possible sense. So it's the same thing. Nothing changes. We look at a different crisis period from September, the Lehman moment, till August 2009, so 1 year from Lehman actually on. And again, you see this is robust, it's not exactly the same, but generally you find the same results. You see second order family coming in, you see first order family far coming in, the neighborhood effect kind of disappears. So we only have the neighborhood effect, which is interesting. We don't quite understand why. We have a neighborhood effect with processed bank exits, but not with their own definition of bank exits. We could, of course, have reported only the processed bank exits, but we prefer not to do that because we don't understand the processed bank. We don't know how the bank decides to call a client processed bank exits. And in our definition, we at least know what we do. And there you don't have the neighborhood effect. Apparently, the bank is better at determining the real exits. We don't know how they do it, and they can't explain us. So we prefer to show these results and then show the processed bank exit results. This is including branch performance. So basically, what do you find is the same thing again. It's very robust again. But here you find also that the branch performance seems to matter and not always significant. Huh? But every once in a while significant. And this basically means that those branches that perform better according to the bank's own measures, so they have service with the clients and they have their measures in terms of selling, and those branches that do better actually have more loyal clients, which is sensible, but it could be endogenous. So we are very cautious with this, but so the results are not. So some people say yes, but this is just driven by branches. Some families live at very bad branches. The manager sucks. He's stealing their money. He's treating them very badly, and that's why they run. So if people start to run together, it just means it's a bad bank branch. And the only thing you measure is branch effects. So basically, that's how we control for the branch performance. I'm sure it's not true. Okay. So that brings me to the conclusion already, and then to the question time. So what we find in general, household peers have a very strong impact on bank exit decisions. Very strong impact. First order family peers have a strong impact on exit decisions. These are not household peers. They're first order family peers living at a different location or having a different bank branch. So they used to be in the same household but moved away. You talk to your parent talks to you. So this is clearly endogenous peer effects in bank exit decisions, but it's not there for neighbors. In crisis times, however, first of all, the intensity of the household effect and the first order family peer effects becomes a lot stronger. It really explodes. The weaker family ties, second order family, start to play a really big role. The size is comparable. And there are all even indications that very weak ties, like neighborhood effects, start to play a role, a small but positive role. So in the end, it amounts to the conclusion that we think we have identified one way of how information about the bank spreads and how bank runs actually happen. It happens, ideally, we'd also look at social networks like Facebook of contact and do the same thing there. But the banks don't know this, we don't know this. So the banks will never give us the names. If you would have the names, you could even look at names on Facebook, see who of these names are connected. But of course, the bank will never give us the names because then you would know everything of these people. It's by the way, also very illegal to do this. So we can't do this. The only thing we could do in the future is ask the bank to do it and then give us the anonymized information. But we are very far from that at the moment, so we're trying to convince them. So ideally, we would love to do that, but now we can do it with family and neighbors, and there you see there is a real effect. So this also means that the policy for banks is suggesting that banks could improve their stability by taking this into account. Look at Deutsche Bank today, right? Deutsche Bank is under pressure, gets a lot of bad news, and they see withdrawals from some big wealthy families. What they need to do, basically, I would say, is other than raising the capital and addressing the problems, is also looking where is it happening, in which families is it happening, and then directly addressing these people. Send your key manager to all the members of the family where you see that the money is going, and talk to them, say, what can you do for you, give them information to stop the run. Because this is how the information spreads through the family networks. Okay, now I'm open for any question or criticisms or yes.
Do you have ages of people?
Yes.
So my kind of concern that you are taking into account not just what people say to each other, but then when they relocate together. If you have a wife,
yes,
and you relocate, then wife will go with you.
Yes, yes, yes.
But your mother is less likely to go with you. So it could be if you just excluded those cases where it's likely that people just relocated, closed their accounts here.
One of the control variables is moving. So it's never driven by people moving, changing their address. Because if you move your address, that's one of the control variables. So relocation of bank branch or relocation of physical, because you have a new job, cannot affect the results because it's controlled for. Is that your question? Is it physical relocation? Another way of hearing the question is it's households moving together if they move. It's not because they have a different job or move physically to another village or city, but they are unhappy with the bank together and they move the funds together. That's possible, but that is only a household effect, not a first order family effect. That's why we have split them. So that's why we have not limited ourselves to this, but split. Exactly because this one of the questions we got, it's a very good question, is it not just people living together and the man who have decided to gather on the bank accounts? It's possible. And that's why we split the close and the far and the family effect itself. And you see that the far, look at the far here, and here it's almost the same. This is even higher, in fact. So it's not people living together in the same bank branch moving together. It's also people connected by family bonds but not living together and even having different bank branch still leaving the bank together. And that's the the so we think this one is crucial, right? The family far is crucial. That's really a family effect, not a household effect. Yes, and then I come to Sophia. Yes, you can, ladies first. Sorry, Sophia.
Thank you for your presentation. It was very interesting and inspiring. I have a question about the size of the family. I think that some people have very big families, some people have very small families.
Yes.
And over here, you count just number of families. And maybe it's and also interesting to look at the fraction of the family. So maybe your whole family is one. And I don't know, your parents is one half, and then your spouse and I don't know, your brother is the other half.
Yes. So, first of all, the small families people have completely. Some people have very small families, and we have 8 times and 8 times. Sometimes you have the whole family actually, because you all have to remember, not all the family members are in the same bank necessarily. Usually not. So you could easily have the whole family. But for big families, we will not have the whole family. However, you have to remember that the initial selection is purely random, and that then we have set to take 8 people and 8 people. The ones you find the easiest. So in that sense, probably we underestimate the effect. Because in large families, there could be people there could be people leaving the bank that were not in the selection, because they were just not in the 8 that were selected, or the 8 of the 8. That's possible. But that would only reinforce the results, because it means that we miss some of the signals of people leaving, we miss because we will not have them in the sample. So it's true, but I don't think it matters for the results.
Actually, I wanted to ask how is this variable of family construction? Because how is it possible just to put all this information about the family links into one variable and to know that this is your brother and this is the brother of another person?
You know, so the bank gives us 10 different kinds of relations. Mm-hmm. And so you know the first and the second round selection of the first 10,000 and 8 people and 8 people. And this first 8, you know their relation to the first person.
Okay.
And then the second 8, you know their relation to one of the first 8.
Okay.
So you have 10,000 guys. And for these 10,000, we make 8 links. There's not always 8 links.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes people live in a street where nobody else lives, remote, and they have very little family. Then you only have 2. But at most 8 links. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And we know the nature of this link. A child, a parent, a neighbor, a married, so or living together. Partner,
sibling,
nephew, aunt. So there's 8 of these. Even someone who is responsible, so your legal custodian or legal guardian for some children that have no parents anymore. And then of each of these 8, you have 8 again. And you also know this. How this looks like, and if you combine this information with this information, you know the total link.
Yeah.
So for every final link, we kind of can calculate what the link is with this guy. You can establish firmly what the link is with this guy, and then we say okay, this link we can call first order or second order.
Okay, and how do you put it into X? So X, family is one variable, right?
So we regress only on these people.
Mm-hmm.
So they are the dependent variable, it's the exit of these guys. And we predict the exit of the 10,000, say, as a function of the exit of the 64, right? 8 times 8. So at most you have 68 people in your network, which is big. And we know how many of these 60 are family, we know how, which guys are neighbors, and you just count how many. We also have a version with a dummy. So actually, we have a version, it's in the paper, and so we have a version where we say, instead of how many family left, just say 1 or 0, and say 1 or 0. And the results are exactly the same. Because not so many people leave the bank after all. Eh? So it's often just 1 or 2. So the case where it's 5 or 6 are actually, there are cases, but there are not so many. So if you just take it as a binary variable, or a continuous variable, as we do, doesn't seem to matter for the results. Camila.
I wanted to ask you, you mentioned the internet, and that's very broad. There's a broad audience who goes to the internet and asks, for example, on Facebook, like, guys, do you have a bank? What I would love, what I'm supposed to go from your side, suggestions. Or, this is a problem that you cannot use this sample in order just to go and check these people on Facebook, Instagram, or whatever. But you can take another sample. People, for example, there should be some kind of forums where are the users of these banks talking to each other, and whether it's really important for them to talk to a person who has already been in this bank for a long time or no. Or maybe, there can be two different samples. The first one, the users of the bank who are already users for some period of time, and others, there can be just a group, like, you know, page of a bank where there are lots of likes. And they're not only users, but also those people who are interested in this bank. And there you could find the information on how do they understand whether they want to go to the bank or not. What do they check for? What do they look at? Maybe this can be, firstly, by interviewing people, it would be easier, but I'm not sure. Maybe you could get it from the page that you would see, because the posts are also reported, how many likes on one post and less on another.
But how would you link it to the behavior? Because you have this information, but what we need to do is link it to individual exits.
You could see if it is important for the person. You have a profile and you have a set of information about the person, where he lives, what age he is, what he's doing in his life, and that's how you could see that maybe there is that is also important for a person who asks for his voices, whether this person lives near to him or not. Whether this person speaks the same language, whether this person does the same job.
So you're suggesting is a different data set where you look at the channels in a completely different way. So you're not going to look at exit, but look at the information they get.
Yes. And whether any kind of ideas, like it also can be family members, mother can also.
But my idea is we overestimate the internet. Especially, you should remember, this is 2012, not 2016. And you should also not forget that most of the people having bank accounts full of money are not people of 20 years old. Huh? My parents have no Facebook. Huh?
No.
I do have Facebook, but I'm not all people of my age have a Facebook, definitely not. So, and also, when this happened, 2008, I didn't have a Facebook. Very few people did have a Facebook. So it's before that also, I think, like you don't believe that neighbors would ever talk about the bank. I don't believe I would ever talk on Facebook about my bank. This is something I'm not going to talk about. Maybe Dutch people would, they're even more transparent. Maybe Russian people would, I don't know. But I would never talk about my bank on Facebook. No, I'm just going to shut up about any financial stuff on Facebook. I will show some pictures of the Russian summer school. But I'm not going to talk about personal financial things. But maybe that's actually changing. It's possible. So it would be in the future very. So if I were a bank, I would definitely monitor if these websites exist or these Facebook groups or contact groups exist. I would monitor them. And if you see, and I would do text search. And if you see a flare on this website of everybody starting about the bank with bad words, so you make a name list of positive words, negative words, and if you see all at once a lot of negative words associated with your bank, you say, oh, we're doing something wrong here.
I know I saw a lot of hashtags, for example.
Yeah.
You talk about Sberbank, and you can just write hashtag Sberbank.
This is a great research proposal. But it's a very different research, though. But it's a great research proposal to see whether this predicts anything. So can you predict the stock price of a bank, or can you predict bank withdrawals by looking at Twitter feeds? That would be fucking cool, actually. Now this is a good idea. Maybe I should do that. You have a question?
Right, so I just wanted to add the fact that if you take your research and the ideas and these ideas here. What you can do, if you go with Twitter, for example, and you see the flare up of the words, you can actually see, because you know, when people leave the bank, they don't just go and take their money and put it under the pillow. They have to take it somewhere. So if you go and you look up, for example, tweets about the uncertainty of the economic situation, crisis times, and you can sort of put it right next to this data you have right here to see if it's actually people leaving the bank for another bank or mm-hmm. people leaving the bank less than people leave other banks. Let's put it that way. So
You're talking about people leaving the banking system altogether.
Yeah, I mean, during the crisis times, or if the family, the household, if they decide to leave this bank, where do they go? Where do they put the money?
Yeah. So we don't know. We don't know at all.
Different banks, you know, different banks will have different numbers for.
We have a general idea because you can look at all the bank balances, of course. And you can see where it is going up or where it's going down. So we have a general idea where the money is going, but we do not have a individual level idea. So this person, where is the money going to? We don't know, but we know in gross terms which banks see their deposits increase and which see them fall. And the bank we are talking about saw their deposits fall considerably the first month after Lehman, and then it stabilized because the government increased the deposit insurance limits, and then the bank was bought by another bank, and then things stabilized. Which is another paper actually we're writing, the effect of deposit insurance and being bought by another bank. Because one of the things, so this is a good question, but so what then you could think, okay, what would happen? Which people will leave and how much will they leave? So if you raise, so in Russia it's 700,000 rubles, so is it more now?
It's more now.
It's more now, right? Andrei knows. 1.4, doubled again, wow. So 1.4. So imagine there's a crisis, and I say very explicitly, deposit insurance is 1.4. Is it for all the banks or per bank in Russia?
Per bank.
So imagine that there was no crisis before, everybody was trusting in the bank, and maybe I have two or three. And all at once is a crisis, and people say explicitly, we increase deposit insurance. You are insured until 1.4. The general effect is going to be to stabilize the banking system. But a side effect will be that people in excess of 1.4 may decide to take the money out of the bank and go to a new bank. You get a mean preserving spread. So the banks won't lose deposits, but all individual banks will see money come and money go because people are spreading their money over different accounts to maximize the insurance. And it's very inefficient. It's costly to have all the bank accounts. It's only to make the best of the insurance. And this creates additional volatility, which is bad for the banks. So you could try to look at these data and see what happens with these both effects and what dominates. So that's something we are looking at today. But even for this paper, we have the same problem, or we could call it frustration. We don't see where the money goes. The bank would tell us, but they're not going to tell us. They will never tell us that. Yes?
Yeah, I'm really interested in the points of domains in the research, particularly in the field of online banking.
Yes.
Do you take into account just the activity of using online banking,
yes,
or a set of activities like using PS or credit or bank cards in it, or just using the bank account via the net?
We have whether they actually are active in online banking, and you have how many times they used the last year the online banking. So how many actions I did on the website, but you do not have what actions.
So you didn't notice any signs of customers who use just only online banking, they are attached to
This is a very interesting question. We didn't look at it.
Because
I see what you're getting at. So your underlying assumption is if people move to online banking, they become more fickle. It's easy for them to run. The switching cost goes down. You don't have to go to the bank. So you could. So what we just do is include online banking. What you should do to us look at this question is make a variable for those people that only do online banking and nothing else, and then see whether this increases the likelihood to exit in crisis times, because it's easier. Yeah. But again, remember, this is the crisis was 2008. Online banking was just in the shoes. Now it's big, André.
Actually, on this point, yes. Online banking is not a product, it's a channel, it's a way of access.
Yes.
Deposit, transfer,
yes.
Loan,
yes.
Mortgage, but online banking is not a product.
So yes.
When you say they only do online banking, they can have a variety of products.
Yeah. It's a channel, it's true. Yeah.
But if you are done with this point, I wanted to ask something.
No, it's true, you're right. Yeah, okay.
Question, I would be interested in your interpretation of some of the findings. For instance, you found that mortgage increases loyalty.
Yes.
How did you drop it down?
For many people in the period we talk about, interest rates were not very low. They then decreased by the end, but they were still relatively high. And you have in Belgium a system, a law that says if you change the mortgage, if you renegotiate the mortgage with another bank, you have a penalty of 3 months. And this penalty is prohibitively high, which makes sure that banks are tied usually to that bank. In addition, in Belgium, if you have a mortgage, you usually have also an insurance, and the insurance is to pay the mortgage. And this insurance, you cannot renegotiate. So once you have a mortgage and you have the insurance with the same bank, which most people do, although they don't have to, you're pretty much tied to the bank. And the banks know this. And they exploit it to charge you more on other products.
Well, then it's not, actually, it doesn't make much sense to include mortgage because these customers are captive in a way.
They're captive. It's a measure of captivity, yes.
Therefore, I thought you mean something else. You mean that the people who have a mortgage loan are less likely to withdraw their deposits. That is another story.
No.
See, if a customer can withdraw without penalties, then this is not a very clean experiment.
Yeah. But this mortgage is just about captivity. That's how you call it also. It's an indicator of captive products. What we have done, which we don't show, is we have done in the paper also estimations where we do not look at leaving the bank altogether, but only leaving the deposits, as you're suggesting. And there, if you include a mortgage, it also works. So having a mortgage also decreases the probability that you withdraw deposits. I don't know. Maybe it's a feeling of entitlement to the bank. They give you credit, and this increases the switching cost. If you go to the bank and say, I withdraw my money, then the person, yes, but I give you a mortgage, and what are you doing? You're my best friend and client. And so I guess having the mortgage creates a maybe not rational switching costs that keeps people more likely to stay with the bank. But it was actually in the paper, so we called this partial exit, but we took it out of the paper because it was getting confused. You have total bank exit, you have partial bank exit, but we have these partial bank exits, we have it for deposits, and we also have it for credits. So you could prepay your loans and go leave the bank like this, and you also have regressions that look at this. Yeah.
Prepaying bonds, what has to do with crisis? I mean, people don't want to lose their savings. Why would you prepay a loan?
Because you renegotiate a loan with another bank. Eh? So basically what you say, I'm not happy with this bank, I'm going to another bank, but I still have the loan there. I would really never see these guys again. So what I will also do at the same time, I will renegotiate my existing loan with another bank and move everything together. Just to get completely rid of it. I don't trust these guys anymore. But it's precisely for these reasons that it's hard to explain what one has to do with the other, we kind of skipped it completely from the paper. We could still look at it, it's all the regressions already, but we decided to restrict ourselves to something very simple, people leaving the bank completely. No activity anymore, nowhere. People are saying, this is it, sell my insurance, I'm gone, I'm out of here. So this is not about deposit runs. Huh? That's why we do not call it deposit run. It's related to that ledger, but we call it bank exit. It's about deciding to take another bank for everything. Also, for example, daily banking. So daily banking is what most of our people do, paying accounts every day, every week. That's what we do most often, right? This is the biggest activity. But you can change this. you could say I will get my wage to another bank, and all my my running transfers, I'll move it in one move to another bank, and I'll pay now from another bank. Yeah? So this is also part of the bank assets. And this is actually the most. So when we have been looking at for this consultancy project in the bank, how can we predict bank assets in other ways than this? One of the best predictors if people move the daily banking. If some people move the daily banking out of the bank to another bank, then it's like a really good predictor of this guy really wants to leave completely. Because it's the hardest thing to do. All the payments and all the things you have arranged to move that from another bank, it's much harder than renegotiating your mortgage. That's just one talk and you have it. You still have a question?
Yes, did I understand correctly that your endogenous variable here is limited between 0 and 1?
Yes.
Yes.
But it's a panel, eh? It's a panel. Eh? So it's one at the moment you leave, and then you disappear from the panel. Eh? Mm-hmm. It stays one, basically.
And why not to use, say, something similar to logit probability?
We could do a panel logit, and you find the same results all over.
Okay.
Yeah. We think this is the best method in terms of, because you have spells, basically. But you could do a panel logit. And then if you do panel logit, basically what you need to do is interact pre-crisis and post instead of split samples. But the disadvantage is if you do panel logit, so why don't we do this? Remember, we have one block of, okay, how do I do this? So in our regressions, we have one block of variables which are the family and the neighborhood variables. You could call these variables the network variables. And then you have like 30 others, right? If we split the sample as we do, we can allow also the slopes of all the 30 others to be different in crisis times and no crisis times. Having an account manager, having a mortgage, having this and that, your age could have different effects in pre, during and post-crisis times. If however you do a panel logit, you will basically interact these things with pre and post-crisis, but all these other things will be assumed the same. If you don't do this, you have to interact every variable, every of the 30 variables, with pre, post and during crisis, and you have 30 times 3, 90 variables, and then this is also, so we had already 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times 3, 15, so you get, so one result table is three pages, it's a mess. So we decided to do it like this, it's much more, I think, understandable. But, so if you do it like this, with all the interactions, you get the same results, of course. This is like a much more presentable way of doing it, yes?
Another missing kind of variable, divorces.
Divorce is included. Divorce is included.
Yeah. I mean, first order family close, far, second order, and you had the third.
It's in the controls. It's in the controls.
It was not.
Yeah, but we think of it as not. This is not. This is just a control variable, basically. Yeah. Mm. So it's in the controls. It's a good point, actually. Maybe we should. We should re-include it. Yes, Sophia. Then I come to you, André. Yeah.
You have information about the decrease of guys in the network.
Yes.
Do you have information about the increase of the number of guys in the network? For example, my son or my daughter is a member of
the band. It's a panel.
Yeah, so you have both the evolution of network and behavior.
Yeah. So I wiped it out, but it could be that someone becomes a network during the sample. Yeah. Yes. So we have many of these. So someone marries,
yes.
A wife appears, and at some point, or husband, or my son marries. So I have a daughter-in-law all at once, in the middle of the sample. So we have a lot of this. So the structure of the network is not. It's dynamic. It's changing over time. So the way we sampled it, it's not dynamic, but it's dynamic. It's changing over time. Yeah. You had a question, André?
Yeah. Sorry for going back to the data issue.
Yes, sure.
Even a very good CRM system, customer relationship management system, only stores and and maintains data which is supplied by the customer itself, because the bank is not an investigator, it cannot spy on the clients and develop its own data. It only uses data of customer supply.
Yes.
So when a customer, a new customer, comes to a Belgian bank, he definitely fills some forms.
Yes.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised to see actually the domicile, the place of work,
yeah.
No form in my life I've seen data about sisters, about siblings, about girlfriends, about aunts, grandmothers, and so on. This data is never supplied to the bank.
Yeah.
How could they supply this data to you if they don't have it?
Oh, they do have it, but it took them 4 months to collect it. So they actively collected it. So one part of the answer is they know every birth and every wedding, because it's public information.
Every what?
Birth.
Oh,
and every wedding they know, and if you know every child and every wedding, you know most of it. Huh? Because if my nephew is nothing else than the son of the brother of my father, and you know the brothers because once they have been born in a family, and from the same father. Huh? So if you only know births,
but how do you do the matching? There are two persons, and they have different days of birth. How does the bank know their brothers?
Because they know the parents.
Provided that the parents are the customers
at
the same time.
Yes, but so imagine you have someone with a lot.
Necessarily, I mean, if you a bank form, do you indicate children there? I
don't. Do you indicate your what?
Children.
No, but at the moment they are born, the bank knows. They will send you even a note: congratulations, a special gift from the bank with the birth of your child. This is public information. They follow. The information in the, you have the state register, and if people are born, it's public information. Yeah. So every, I'm not sure how it works in Russia, but in Belgium, if you give birth to, you get boxes with all kinds of goodies from all kinds of shops, it's public information, they know, the banks know it too.
Not from the bank.
Sorry?
Not from the bank.
No, but the banks knows it, and they include it in their data sets. These firms are not from the bank, but they know it from the public register. Huh? So my son is born, I go to the city and I say I have to declare the birth of my son, and this is public information. And if you know all the births, and you know the weddings, and you know the bank knows the addresses. So if two people on the same address legally they are living together, and then they're married or partners. A far family, my nephew is simply the son of the brother of my father, and the two brothers, my father and the uncle, they have a father and since if the bank knows the father, he knows the two sons, they know they are brothers, and I know the son of the brother, and I know me, I'm the son of my father, so I can make the link to the nephew. If you know only childhood and living together, you can reconstruct all the rest. Huh? And that's what the bank does. Reconstruct all the links. And then also, so imagine then you have my nephew is the son of the brother, and he marries, but the bank sees the wedding. So I can know in my data set, actually, the wife of my nephew. It's possible. So, I agree, it's pretty cool. It's also pretty scary, I would say. So it's scary. They know a lot. I think Google knows more, in fact. and Vkontakte probably knows more, but the banks also know a lot. Yeah. Then we're screwed. Yes, this will happen, right? This is what's going on today. So you see, Google has a bank license in the Netherlands and Belgium. Apple has one. Apple just started doing Apple Pay in Russia. Yeah. So it's happening. Yeah? But in 10 years, the world will look very different, and the banks will be under a lot of stress. So that will be the uphill fight for the banks. So actually, I think the banks have more data than Google, but they do not have more information. So that's a project I have with the same bank. A new project, let me explain the project in broad terms. You want to predict individual deposit behavior by looking also, so the bank has all the payments, people make to each other, people make to firms, firms make to other firms, firms make to people. So you have wages, you have consumption, you have everything. They have 12 billion payments. It's a huge mountain of payments. This is much more information than Google has. They know all the employment relations. They know how much you consume and what you consume. But they're not using it. It's lying in the huge heap of data, but it's not information. So what Google does is put algorithms on the data and gets information. So once the banks understand, oh, we are in problem, they could beat Google easily if they just could get around it. But they're very bad at IT, they're horrible at algorithms and data mining and all these things. So they need to invest into this. This is what they need to do very quickly.
What they don't have is that they don't know your location at the moment, right? And this is where Google comes into play, because Google knows where you are, knows you're next to a certain store, can give you an offer, and so on and so on. So actually, if you combine the data, because if you use Android, and basically Android gives you unlimited access to the bank application can have unlimited access into your private life, looking at to whom you chat.
Yeah, but if I were a bank, what I would do is I would send every customer an application on their mobile phone for payments.
Some banks do this.
For payments and then make sure that I also have the geolocation. So it's one box you tick, I send the geolocation.
You don't need a form anymore. As soon as you install the application, accept on the terms.
Yeah, yeah. So I have now an application of the bank, BankContact, which makes the which. So I could if I have this. Let me show it to you. So this new evolution, which is bad actually. So it's called this BankContact. Oh, and I can add the card, and then if I need to pay you 5 rubles, I could do it like this. If you have the same app. Bloop, bloop, and you pay. Of course, the banks know where I am. They know that I'm in Russia, if they would bother to look. So there's nothing Google does the banks couldn't do. They're just too far behind in their thinking. They think about stone, about big marmor ties, but that's not what people want in the future. People need service and data and information. So banks need to get active and invest in data scientists, I think.
Saying contradicts your findings. You say that the branches don't matter. So actually, what matters is the CRM. Your own findings suggest that.
I don't understand.
Whether the branch was good or bad.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't really matter anymore because.
In the future, no. In the future, no.
Even now.
Well.
People are not that attached to the banks. Some people don't go to banks for years.
Yeah,
they
receive
everything by mail, and they use ATMs to withdraw funds and so on. So
yeah. But all people above 50 are very attached to the banks, and they have 90% of the money, I guess. So banks still have a window, I think, of 10 years. All these people start dying slowly, and if the people like us, we go into our 50s within some period, and then things will get very bad for the banks. But at the moment, they still have a window because there's still a huge switching cost for the old generation. But you young guys, you won't give a shit, right? The bank doesn't matter. It's something you do online. So you're right. Actually, it's going to completely change.
Not necessarily. I mean, people like online banking, but they don't accept online banks. People need to understand that there is offline bank, and if there is, they like online banking. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean. Yeah. I know exactly what you mean. So the online, what you're basically saying is the online is built on the reputation of the offline. And it's like you said, actually, it's just a channel. It's not an identity. But of course, then you have Google, Apple, and they already have an identity and a reputation. And they could be only offline, because they are only offline, actually. So it's to be seen, right? So you have these challengers that actually do not have a physical bank, but they are a bank already. So Google does this already, right? Google already gives credits to firms for Google Ads. So if I'm a small firm and I want to buy Google Ads, I can get a credit from Google and pay later. Now this is just a banking service, and they have a banking license for it. It's credits. Google sells how many billions a year in ads? I don't know, but it's more than 10 billion, I think. And they give credits on this. So quickly, this is becoming... So if I were a bank, I would be worried at least a bit. it's going to come, right? At some point it's going to, so you don't see it, and then it's always going to be there, and it's exponential. It's something like this. So it means until here, there's nothing to worry about. And then the last year, you're dead. That's how it goes. These things are exponential. So you, I think if I were a bank, I would prepare very hard for this, because this is coming nevertheless. But this is completely outside the scope of the paper, definitely, but it was interesting to think about it. All right, any more questions? No? Then we're off to drinks. Thank you for the attention, and see you next time.